Hello guys, welcome to the course in Introduction to Computing and Basic Computing Principles. So in this course, we will cover more or less everything that is a part of your BTech syllabus. And we shall initially study about some basics of computer and operating systems, and gradually we will move on to programming with C. And at the end of this course, or rather at the end of this video series, we will also devote two videos to making of a complete project. And that project you can use as your mini project in C. So let us start. In this video, we will study about history and generations of computers. So the history of computers basically dates back to more than 5,000 years ago. And one of the first machines that was invented was the Abacus. And this Abacus is used even today. The few operations that this machine can perform are the basic calculations, that is addition, multiplication, and so on. And this was a great invention because this actually was the start to the era of the computers. And after the Abacus was invented, Blaise Pascal in 1642 invented the basic adding machine, which was based on few mechanical gears. And in this machine, the numbers were represented by cogs on the wheels. This was basically a mechanical machine and was to be operated manually with hands. And hence it was not so efficient, but was quite an invention at that point of time. Later on in the 1830s, after a long difference of time, Charles Babbage invented his difference engine, which was made out of brass and pewter rods and gears. And later on, he modified this machine further, and that machine came to be known as the analytical engine. So his design contained the five key components, and these five key components are those which are even used today in the upgraded computers as well, because these were the basic or the fundamental parts of a computer. So namely, they were the input device, a storage for numbers, or rather we can call it as the memory. There was a processor, there was a basic control unit, and an output device. And this is the reason why Charles Babbage is known as the father of computers, because it is the basic five devices which he introduced into his analytical engine is what even form the major part of our computers or advanced computers that we use today. So that is why all credit to the invention of computer goes to Charles Babbage, and hence he is known as father of computers after the machine that he designed, that was the analytical engine. Now we take a look at the generations of the computer. So as we all know that the computer which we used long ago were composed of vacuum tubes, which was used as the internal components. This first generation is the era starting from 1943, and more or less it resumed till 1958. So in these, the building block was the vacuum tubes, but there was a very major problem with these tubes, because there were frequent tube failures, and moreover, most importantly, these tubes, the operation of these tubes consumed a huge amount of power, and hence was a wastage of electricity. And the length of these tubes was nearly 5 to 10 centimeters, and there were thousands of such tubes in a single computer, which we can't even imagine of in the modern day computers. An example of this is the UNIVAC machine, and these computers were huge in size. They occupied nearly a complete room. So this is one image of the Colossus Mark II, which contained 2400 such vacuum tubes. And to the right side of this slide, you can see some vacuum tubes. These are the tubes from some computers of 1950s era. So you can see the size of each tube, and you can imagine by yourself how much large would the computer be for a computer that had 2400 such vacuum tubes. Okay, so that led to the invention of the second generation computers, which started at 1959 and resumed till 1964. So these computers used transistors, which were very fast as compared to the operation of the vacuum tube computers, and these were highly reliable as well, because the degree of failure that was expected by these computers were very less as compared to that in the first generation computers using vacuum tubes. And moreover, the transistors, as because they were the semiconductor devices, they used very less power. And in this period itself, there was the concept of assembler languages or assembly languages, which was invented. Example of the second generation computers include the IBM 1401 and Honeywell. Now, use of the transistor also reduced the size of computers by a great degree. In this example, or rather in this picture, you can see a computing machine. This has four major components. The first is the CPU, the central processing unit. This is a machine of, this is a picture of IBM 1401. So there is the CPU. Here is one printer. There is a external memory or the added memory. And here is one card reader or punch. And all the instructions that were to be executed by the computer, or rather this CPU, were given using this card reader, using punched cards. So after the second generation, we have the third generation of computer, which started in 1965 and continued till nearly 1970 or 72. And in this generation, it marked the beginning of integrated chips or integrated circuits. So nearly hundreds of components were integrated on a single chip. So again, these were semiconducting chips, and hence the amount of power that they used was very less. So these and this integration, this high integration, or rather integration of 100 components on a single chip, again reduced the size of the computers by a great deal. So also there was a huge reduction in cost because the amount of power consumption was reduced, and moreover the size led to a lower cost. Or lower size led to a lower cost. So in this generation, the third generation languages were also enabled. And these third generation languages enabled multitasking as well. That means multiple operations could be computed, or multiple operations could be performed at the same time. Some examples are PDP-8, PDP-11, IBM 360 and IBM 370. So this invention of these integrated circuits was a great achievement in the field of computer, or rather computing, because they completely changed the direction of how people would think. So this is an example of the PDP-8 machine. This is the central processing unit, and over here you can see a stack of layers or a stack of board kind of things. So all these boards contain integrated circuits into them, and if you can nicely see over here we can see a connection between two boards. So this is using the buses or cables. Okay, so this is a processor of PDP-8 and here is the complete computer. In this one there are few magnetic tapes and so on, and over here if you can see, it's written data field, instruction field, program counter, memory address, memory buffer, accumulator, multiplier and quotient, and this is the step counter. So this is basically a device which would show you the various instructions that you enter. So you could input, or you can provide input using this particular picture that you see over here, this device. So as you can see, these instructions, I mean these many fields, that is the data field, instruction field, etc., this was the use of the assembly language programming over here. And after this third generation computers, we have the fourth generation computers. So today the computers that we generally use are the part of the fourth generation. This began nearly around 1971. This fourth generation began nearly around 1971. And till now, there is no clear distinction between the fourth generation and the fifth generation. Actually, fifth generation is supposed to be the artificial computing, or the artificially intelligent computers. So current generation that we are using have large scale integration and very large scale integration incorporated into them. So that is the fourth generation of computers. In this, we have thousands of chips, or rather thousands of components, maybe more than that, integrated into a single chip. And that is the very reason why we see that the size of the computers that we use today are so less. In fact, we can even carry our computers or laptops in our hand. and moreover, we also have our mobiles. So all this change from such a large size of computers to such small size of computers has arrived only because of the invention of this integrated circuits. And moreover, it has also led to a huge reduction in the cost. Because earlier, when we were in the era of the first generation or the second generation computers, nobody could even in their dreams imagine of purchasing a personal computer because that was not at all feasible. But today, more or less every home has at least one computer or at least one mobile phone everybody is using. So that is how the computers have advanced, starting from the Abacus to the today's fourth generation or today's laptops and mobiles and computers. And the fifth generation is supposedly going to be the artificially intelligent computers in which you don't have to practically do anything. Your computers will be smart enough to learn everything from the environment just by seeing or by some initial processing that you do to them. So that is all for this video. In the next video, we shall be studying about classification of computers. Thank you.